Hello everyone, thanks for having me today. Today we're going to talk about institutional dimensions of social ecological systems. I'll try to make it as short and as informal and as simple as I can, because I can relate. I will tell my story here. I also come from a natural science background and moved through master's and PhD into the social science. So today I'm going to talk a little bit about my my socio-ecological journey. So my research nowadays, it's about policy, institutions, and management, and how they influence how people interact with their environment in the context of change, like climate change, environmental change. And it's multidisciplinary by nature, which means that I've been collaborating with a number of colleagues and organizations from Australia and overseas. But that's today. As I said, in my previous life, I was a natural scientist. And this guy was someone that influenced my decision in doing marine science. Some of you might be too young to recognize, and the old ones might, you know, he may not being so popular in this part of the world, but this is Jacques Cousteau. He's a French naval officer who was, when I was growing up, he, you know, I watched a lot of Jacques Cousteau. It was, he had his research vessel and sail around the world doing documentaries and looking at different aspects of marine life, and being also to the Amazon, Brazil, where I'm from. So I was growing up watching Jacques Cousteau and having a close relation to the sea as well. My parents had a shack on the coast of northern Brazil. I decided to do a marine science. So I moved to the south of Brazil to do a degree in oceanography. And during my honors, I looked at primary production of salt marsh. I also had I did a major in environmental management. And when I finished my honors in primary production, I realized that my honors, or this, you know, the natural science, that, you know, wasn't alone enough for me to answer the questions I was interested in. For example, they were using the salt marsh for grazing, for dumping garbage, and I said, "Oh, I need to. These are interesting. These are urgent issues, and I need to have a more knowledge of the social dimensions and the policy." And then I decided to do a master's in geography, where I looked at mangroves management in urban situations. So moving from the temperate, subtemperate zone to more tropical area. So look at it. At this town here in northern Brazil, where the mangroves are usually, what's the word for that? They are reclaimed for, you know, the people from lower economic background. They, because the whole story is that this is the heartland for cocoa production in Brazil. And because of prices in the cocoa industry, due to lower prices in terms of production in Africa, and a deadly disease that, you know, nearly terminated the created great damage to the cocoa production in southern Bahia, in Brazil. So people moved from these rural areas to the city, and then getting there, the only places that they were available for them to occupy were protected areas. And even though Brazil has some nice environmental legislation, it's not enforced. and also has very social and political costs to enforce. So I was looking at the issue and the people, how the, you know, the mongrels were being occupied, and then the impacts, and then I looked at the legislation and did some interviews with some of the stakeholders, organizations that were supposed to be responsible in some way in resolving the problem, and did my master's on that. And then from that study, I realized that the main problems with the mangroves were actually coming from the catchment. So I said, oh, you know, it's land use change in the catchment. People coming to the coast, and that's the where they think that's the root cause of the impacts are. And also with the land use, there was also other issues that would impact the coast. And I had this brilliant idea. I'm going to do a PhD and look at how catchment management can incorporate coastal and marine management or marine issues into their management. And then I came to Wollongong to do a PhD. And I started looking at the, at the time, they had the catchment management boards. And I was looking at how they operated. And it was a coastal catchment management entity, how they operated and how they were incorporating coastal and marine issues and how could we improve that. And it was maybe 8 months or into my PhD, the New South Wales government decided to disband the catchment management boards. And I say, what am I going to do now? The new entity is going to take a few years to get up and running and be operational and have the plans. And I used to do my PhD. Then I realized that this was the third time they were changing the policy. And I said, oh, hang on a minute. I could look at a policy change over time. That would be nice. And also, there was, I remember the main discourse, the main argument by the government was that we are devolving decision-making to the regions. You know, we are devolving decision-making to the, you know, people, to the local level. I said, okay, let's do it. Let's compare the change, what's happening over time, and see how it's translating into meaningful decision-making evolution. So what I'm trying to say with this story is that I started my academic or professional activities or career from a perspective of the sort of the ecological system and expanded to something that is to encompass the social and political dimensions. And within this context, I became very interested in institutions. When I say institutions, it's not organizations. We also usually use the term institution as interchangeably for organizations. Like the UQ is a higher education institution. But in terms of institutional theory, institutions are rules. Are rules of, you know, they're called the rules of the game. The rules that define how we interact with the environment and how we interact with ourselves. So I'm interested in the formal and informal arrangements that mediate human and environment interactions, like the legislation, policies, decision-making procedures, and social and customary norms. Even though my research is more on the formal side of it, there's a lot of people that work looking at the local level, looking at how traditional communities self-organize and create their own rules to manage their environment. And this is the second person that influenced my, the first one was influenced my ecological journey, and this one influenced much of my research, my formative years as a social scientist. She was a political economist, an American political economist. many of you may know or have heard about her. She works with Common Core Resources, and she started her research on Common Core Resources based on a paper published on science in 1968 by American economist, if I'm not wrong, Gerhard Hagen, who published a paper saying that natural resource can only be managed by either government or by the private sector. If you give it to the people, they're going to mess up and they're going to... The paper was called The Tragedy of the Commons. And then he demonstrates through a narrative how people sharing the same resources would face incentives to get more and more resources rather than manage in a sustainable way. And then Elinor Ostrom said, hang on a minute, I don't agree with that. And then she started working with traditional communities around the world and looking at different communities. She realized that in the absence of government and the private sector, the empirical evidence is that communities can self-organize and create the rules to manage their resources in a sustainable way. So that was she was awarded the Nobel in Economic Science for that work with the Common Core Resources. And these were some of the bedside books during my PhD. So what I'm going to show next is a few examples of my research on different aspects of institutions, just to illustrate what I do and what institutions are about. So this was part of my PhD. As I said, I looked at capital management. I had that grand idea of looking at post-marine issues in capital management and end up doing an institutional analysis over time. So this is what happened in New South Wales. In the late 80s, you know, they realized that the natural resources needed to be managed on a catchment basis because soil, water, vegetation, they're all interlinked and you need to have coordination. So they decided to adopt as a policy of a catchment management approach where the natural resources within a catchment would be coordinated by a catchment management entity. And then they changed, as I said, they established the committees in the late 90s, 80s, and then later in the late 90s, in the mid-90s, they did a review. Let's review the catchment management policy and came up with some, they reviewed consultants came up with some suggestions. They didn't adopt most of the suggestions, but they decided to have a policy reform there and created the catchment management boards. So that's in the beginning of 2000s when I started my PhD before they finished with the boards and created the authorities, as I said. What I'm trying to say that institutions, they change over time in response to environmental, socioeconomic, and political imperatives. So not always for the best reason as we think. As coming from a natural science background, one of my questions back then was that why don't they look at the science when before they make the decisions? But you know, getting a better understanding of the policy process, science is one aspect of a complex process of decision making. But that's a talk for another day. So what I did in that study was to, first of all, based on the theory on institutions coming from the Common Core Resources, the school of thought, institutions can be classified in terms of different categories of rules. And these category of rules, they affect the social space where individuals and organizations interact when they're addressing environmental issues or any other issues for that matter. So what we did was look at these catchment management arrangements in terms of these types of institutions. We looked at, you know, institutions define the participants in those catchment entities, you know, how they were selected, what kind of authority and power would over to them, arrangements for accountability, like reporting and monitoring, resources, and the functional and geographic scope. So we look at how these varied over time and use the key attributes of collaborative management of governance to assess the changes. And what we found was that even though the government was trying to improve the system, to improve performance and outcomes of these so-called institutions, there were constraints. If you look from a perspective of collaborative governance, constraints in terms of key features of collaboration, such as inclusive participation, devolution of power and authority, and downwards accountability. So the process there was one that was moving from a collaborative type of management towards one of deconcentration, which is the same as administrative decentralization, which is a weaker form of decentralization. So in the end, the government was saying, oh, we're devolving power to the region. They were, but as they understand how power is devolved. But if you look from a collaborative perspective, they were not doing much in that sense. The other example that I wanna show today is from the Great Barrier Reef. As you know, many of you know, climate change is the elephant in the room, and it's been recognized as the major long-term threat to the reef, at least since the first Outlook report. But scientific papers have been talking about that for ages. So in this research, we were interested in looking at what kind of adaptation strategies were taking place in the Great Barrier Reef region, not only in the marine park, but in the catchment. But we were also interested in looking at multi-level governance. That was because complex problems like climate change are believed to be better addressed at multiple scales. Like, these problems manifest at different levels and scales and accordingly should be addressed at that scale. So we want to gain some insights into that too. So what we did was we analyzed over 100 adaptation strategies at local, regional, state, and federal levels. And we're looking at what the type of adaptation was happening, how they went fast, what their intent were, driving triggers and so forth. And also the interplay, which was one of the main, at that time was my main interest, and I will talk a little bit about that. So we identified several instances of interplay, which is basically looking at how different strategies interact with each other, and interplay can be both positive and negative. They can create synergies, but they also can create conflicts. So that was part of our study. And this is a graph representation of part of the interplay that we looked at. And you see how the different policies, strategies and plans and legislation were linked through different levels of government. We came to our paper suggests that multi-level approaches is a necessary but not sufficient approach to complex problems. Most of the adaptation strategies that we looked at the Great Barrier Reef. At that time, there were short-term adaptation measures. There were 2 to 3 years at most. They were predominantly incremental, sectorial, and top-down. And they lacked a framework to managing those interactions. So the interactions were there, they affect of life, but there were no mechanisms to either take advantage of the interactions or to avoid conflicts and negative effects from those interactions. So another example is from the Coral Triangle. Many of you may have heard about the Coral Triangle. It's a global conservation hotspot in Southeast Asia and the Pacific. Nevertheless, it's been subjected to threats, destructive fishing practices, pollution, and climate change. And in 2009, the 6 countries involved in the Coral Triangle that are part of the Coral Triangle, with the help of NGOs and the government of Australia and the USA, they launched the Coral Triangle Initiative, which aimed to address the threats to the marine coastal and all the ecosystems in the Coral Triangle. One of the core elements of the Coral Triangle Initiative is the Regional Plan of Action. So they had 5 overarching goals. Priorities, scales, ecosystem-based approach to fisheries, marine protected areas, climate change adaptation, and fairness. But one of the key principles of the regional plan of action was that the plan should be implemented in the existing context and use the existing international agreements as a leverage. So the question for us was, what are the existing governance arrangements in the Coral Triangle that apply to marine conservation and management, and how they would support the goals of the Coral Triangle Initiative? For this project, was that a bit by chance, I found a paper very interesting looking at network analysis applied to ocean governance in the United States. And then I got in touch with the author, and then we found we had some interesting comments and said, oh, let's do something together. And then that's how this paper came about. So we developed, someone developed a data set, a research assistant, collected nearly 200 documents and formatted the documents, created the database so we could analyze. So we collected nearly 200 documents, including international and multilateral arrangements that were relevant to the Coral Triangle management and conservation. And then there is a software that does the automated content analysis and come up with the numbers. And we found the different environmental agreements they cover the Coral Triangle goals in different extents. This is just an example to prepare you to what's coming next, so you don't be too scared. So this is the Coral Triangle Initiative Regional Plan, which is this diamond shape here, and it means that each of these countries are a part of the original play, right? So that's what we did. So it's we mapped the international landscape, governance landscape, and see okay, what's the you know in terms of binding and non-binding agreements, and if they were regional or global, and you know these are the agreements that all the six countries are part of, and then you also have bilateral or multilateral arrangements at the sub-regional level. And then we look at, you know, at first how the different arrangements was addressing the objectives of the CTI. And this is for fisheries. So you see the basic assumption in this graph here is that the larger the size of the figure, the more important that talk is in that particular arrangement. But there are assumptions behind it, but I won't go into detail. We can talk about that if you want a bit later. And later, well, this research led to something else, which I thought was really and truly a socio-ecological approach to understanding, you know, the relationship between the social dimension and the ecological dimension. So a few years later, after finishing this, Eric Trammell, that I think many of you may know, he was here. He's now in Melbourne, but he was here at UQ, and he's marine ecologist. He got in touch. He said, "Oh, I want to do I want to map the ecological. I want to look at the ecological network in the Coral Triangle, and look and see how it matched the policy network." So in the theory, there's this thing called the problem of fit that says that the policy dimension or the governance dimension needs to fit into the characteristics of the ecological system that was developed to govern. And Eric said, "Oh, I want to do that. I want to look at." I don't have this license to show, but and I don't have the math background to explain all the details of the. But he did the math, and he just said, "Okay, well, you do the math. You just tell me what you need from me, and then myself and Julie, who work in this project, we did the same. We did the network according to his needs, and then he came up with the calculations, and he." He coupled the two, and they said, "Okay, that's it." And one of the things. This was probably the first study to look at to try to quantify the problem of fit between social and ecological systems. And the other thing was that we found interesting was that some of the most important ecological networks were not covered by the policy. So policy was lacking. There was a policy gap for some of the most important ecological links there. Okay, but that's something else, a bit of abstraction. So with that study, we found that it was pretty much what we were dealing with was a true example of international environmental governance, where multiple policy domains exist. There are different institutional arrangements, and there is variability in terms of geographic scope and subject matter, and also complex and fragmented systems with jurisdictional and functional overlaps. And Eduardo knows that he's doing looking at the international arrangements applied to migratory birds. So he's doing some interesting stuff in that space. And then we suggest that in this context, one entry point to try to manage that, you know, this messiness and the fragmentation would be interplay management, which is, you know, institutional learning and institutional synergy. Basically, getting people that working in these different institutions to in some ways, come together in different forums and create the learning that they need. And in the case of the cultural language, it was already happening. I can't remember the exact example, but some of the secretariats for these conventions, they were working together, sharing information, what they were involved in some of the entities were involved in joint data collection. So these, over time, according to the theory, will improve the system. So what I was trying to say with this presentation is that institutions, they are the rules of the game. They are important, not the most important. They are all the factors important in terms of regulating environmental, human and environmental interactions, but it's an important part of that interaction. They are complex, they have complex dynamics, they change over time, but they also can be changed by humans. That's another story, there's lots of theories on that. They span multiple levels, and they feature pervasive interactions. So I'll talk a little bit more about that, because this is one of my main interests. So, future directions in terms of research on institutions, according to my perspective. So, complexity and interdependence are some of the major features in social cultural systems. So, this is something that I attracted me to looking at the governance of social cultural systems. They're interested in multi-level governance. It's been the theory of the literature says that it's better governance. You can achieve better governance using multi-level approach, but we don't know much about what are the configurations. Multi-level configurations would improve performance and outcomes. So in these contexts, I'm interested in looking at what I recommend if you keen on study institutions. Diversity is one of the, biodiversity for institutions is also important. You know the importance of biodiversity for the ecological system. For policy systems, it's the same. You know, you can have only one type of solution. It's more complex than that. You need a variety of approaches and institutions and to tackle the problem. So that's, but we don't know much about that. It's all, we don't have much empirical evidence of how diversity or redundancy can help in improving robustness. So this is, you know what I mean, but again, multi-level governance. This is actually a project that I'm working at the moment as part of the Reef Restoration and Adaptation Program, which is a program led by AIMS, the Australian Institute of Marine Science, and they are proposing a research program that look at innovative interventions in the Great Barrier Reef to address climate change, and we're looking at the implications in terms of governance if they are to deploy these interventions. Another topic that I'm fascinated is the role of institutions in supporting adaptation and transformation. institution, and that's the tension nowadays, because now we are living in days that changes are happening very quickly, and institutions, they are by nature they are stable, they are difficult to change, because they need to give certainty for society to work. You can't change the rules all the time. But now we are in a place where, you know, our context has changed dramatically, and the institutions that we have no longer are adequate to address the problems that we have. So how institutions can support adaptation and transformation? That's a question that I find very keen. And I'll leave it here. If you have any questions. Certainly do look at the interlinkages and see which ones are synergetic and the ones that are negative, and based on that make recommendations.
Yeah.
The main problem is changing, making the change on the ground. As you know, decision making doesn't follow rational a rational path. It makes sense if you apply political science models. You can say, "Oh, yeah, it makes sense." And I can, you know, there was an example. Well, Kelly Fielding must have touched upon that last week on her presentation on how decisions are more about values, political costs, political orientation, rather than choice. Rather than science. And there's a good example, I don't know if Kelly talked about that, was the water supply in Toowoomba a few years ago, where the federal government said, okay, we fund this recycling or plant, water plant, but we want to hear from the community. And then there was a big debate, that's sewerage water, we don't want to drink sewerage, and blah blah blah, and it was that debate, and then bring the scientists, and the scientists said, oh, this water, the recycled water, is cleaner than the water that you actually drink it from the tap now. But doesn't matter, you know, people were not prepared to drink recycled water. So that's how, you know, and the politicians will not take the social and political risks in imposing a science only based decision on the community. So that's how it works. So, having said that, you know, one of the suggestions for scientists is to engage in the policy process, because most of from my old days, my mindset was, so I'm a scientist, I'm going to produce the data, and here's the data, here's the evidence, make your decision. It doesn't work like that. You know, in Canberra, the different groups lobbying the government to make decisions that are more appropriate to their own interests. We are stakeholders as well, and we have our own interests. So the way that it's not about showing the science, but also engaging with the decision-making process, which can be a long endeavor, but that's the way that we and one case that I was fascinated by that, I thought of writing a paper, but I never had the time, was the if you remember the super trawler issue in Tasmania. The science said, okay, bring the super trawler, it's sustainable. But the community couldn't accept that. said, no, 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 no. And then I remember that one night, the Minister for the Environment, I don't remember his name, that was Labour, he said, look, he was interviewed, look, there's nothing we can do about the super trawler. It's all legal, it's all been through the legal process. Well, all that we can need is to make sure that they follow the rules. That was one night. The next morning, he called for a review of the Australian fisheries policy, meaning that all the super trawler could not operate on that basis because the policy was going to be reviewed for a couple of years. But there was two things. He's saying he said, oh no, the science is bad. Implicitly, he said, the science from the Australian Fisheries Management Authority, you know, we can trust, implicitly, whereas Australia had one of the best fisheries management in the world. But that was all about, the social pressure, the advocacy. So that's how you influence the policy process, the decisions. So I say, yeah, it's feasible to diagnose where the problems are and how, but institutions are, in changing institutions are complex, lots of issues, and also they are complex how they interact. So you can change one bit here and create another problem down the road. So it's Ostrom, that lady, she said that there's no optimal policy solution. We always work with suboptimal, and don't go for optimal solution because it doesn't exist. It's about trial and error. You go for one solution, it doesn't work, you need to review and adjust. But yeah, it's a complex landscape, but it's fascinating.